Okay, Aura. As far as I understand through the brain rot vernacular that's been given to us in the last few years, aura is indicative of a person's kind of imposing stature, at least that you are supposed to have a commanding presence. Like, it doesn't necessarily mean that the person has to be menacing, but at least commands a certain presence, because having immaculate amount of riz also implies here. I am so looking forward to the next generation of professionals. Like, imagine going to the doctor and being like, "Doc, what am I feeling?" "On guard, my dude, you're about to get full send cause you got skibbity cancer." But in today's video, we have something here from the Casual Geographic channel on the best aura moments in nature. This is going to be fun, so without further ado, let's just get into it. Oh yeah, the untitled ghost.
Aura. You've heard the word, even if it was after the brain rot brigade ruined it for everyone. The definition of aura is not important, it's the feeling. It's commanding an entire room without speaking. It's when your name is spoken, it demands respect. Man, look, we don't even need this intro, you know what aura is. Captain America wielding the hammer of Thor? Aura. Aura. Steph Curry having an entire building watching him shoot? Except for Steph Curry? Aura.
Look, I'm not even that big of an NBA fan, but this man has the showmanship of a god. Like, have you all seen the shenanigans going on with Steph Curry and Trae Young? Like, the dude would be staring Trae Young in the eyes like, "I'm not looking at that shot. It's going in." He is mad good.
Experts advising tourists against even saying this bear's name for their safety? Aura. Animals can have it too, and when you talk about aura, this bear might just grizzly. Be the mascot. This is bear number 122, but he's mainly known as the boss. He's a 700-pound walking boulder of a bear and the most dominant grizzly in Banff National Park in Alberta. He's your biggest predator's biggest predator.
Excuse me? Banff? I'm sorry, I know, but Banff.
The boss has been recorded catching, murking, and eating other bears. In fact, one of the first times he ever was seen was while feeding on a recently expired black bear. Or at least what was left of him, and officials had to close down the Sundance Canyon Trail until he was done. He's like—
I mean, it's black bears. Those are literally like dogs. My neighbor has a dog that is bigger than a black bear. Well, at least when he stands on his hinds.
Like the carnivore conductor, everyone has to follow his timing. He's always the last bear to hibernate, but the first one up. He has a home range of about 1,000 square miles, and like Genghis Grizzly, Boss is believed to have fathered 70% of all the bears in Banff. Brother Bear was going to work, but unfortunately, with every eventually you retire, and one day Boss tragically hit a train and was put down. The train, that is. Yeah, this walking plot armor survived being struck by a train twice. Mind you, trains are the number one killer of all wildlife in Banff, and Boss regularly uses the tracks as a buffet line to feed on spilled grain.
Hey, well, I guess that if you're an object of locomotion, he's gonna go against you. So, wait a minute. So, if he survived trains, how does he handle cars?
The carcasses of other animals that weren't strong enough to survive what he walked off twice. The definition of aura is a bear covered in oil from hours spent eating off the same tracks that should have killed him. But this God of War grizzly doesn't just not fear death, he straight up disrespects it. According to Parks Canada mapping, Boss regularly crosses high-speed, heavy-traffic highways like TransCanada, and yeah, in case you were curious, that's another leading cause of bears getting disqualified from life. And that's not the only way he disregards death. Believe it or not, if there was something less than nothing, bears would want that to do with us. The best way to avoid a bear is to make enough noise to give the bear a chance to avoid you, and mother bears will actually den closer to people, knowing that'll keep baby-aborting males away. Which means, ironically, some bears choose the man. Boss chooses himself. Bear 122 is a common visitor of compost around Banff, and he even forced the town to put up a 9,500-volt electric fence just to keep him from raiding the landfills. There's also that time you had Boss breaking into backyards just to eat from fruit trees. So of course the only option was to cut down the trees. Thing is, Boss was never known to be aggressive to people. To be fair, that's also true for most bears that are alive, but my theory—
he does not give a damn about anybody. This is my land. You built here, in nature. My folks were here before you. I'm going in. Y'all seem to forget what my nickname is. I'm the boss. That is genuinely frightening.
He is. He knows damn well we can't do a thing about him. Boss is a whole anime protagonist with predatory hardware, so you shouldn't be surprised that he has his own villain. One day, wildlife photographer John E. Marriott seemingly saw Boss at his worst. He could barely move, he had chunks taken out of his face, and for the first time, he had gotten got. And the most likely culprit, yeah, that would be this guy, Split Lip. Split Lip, or Bear 136, was another mountain of a bear in Banff, and Boss's number one op. They even have the same ursicidal tendencies. In 2015, his tracking collar stopped working, and researchers looking for it were met with Split Lip's discarded collar and a mostly eaten grizzly corpse that wasn't Split Lip.
Split Lip is another monster. And this time, he eats his equals. Dude probably ate something that was his size. No wonder why he did so well in the conflicts against the boss. He was like, young man, I did this way before you. Don't let that bravado go to your head. I don't know why I'm giving them so much personality, but yeah. Could be fun for an anime.
They've been running Fates for years, and with both being at least over 20, this beef's likely been marinating over a decade. And with Boss estimated at 28, he proves one thing. Beware the old man in a profession where men die young. In fact, even his name is dangerous. Just not in the way you think. You see, when you name an animal, you're basically personalizing them. It's one thing to do it to a dog. It's a different game for a 700-pound wild Rottweiler. It turns animals into celebrities. If you think someone's not logic deficient enough to risk it all for a Boss selfie, yeah, Bison is more than a goodbye. It's enough for experts to caution against saying his name out of fear that he might literally gain too much clout for his own good. Think about it. This bear's aura is too strong to have a name. But there's more than one kind of aura, even in the animal world. You ever get that new kid in class that everyone just rocks with? Like the popular kids, the teachers, he can make nice with half the school by lunch.
The capybaras. I wish that I had half the charisma. Me before high school, making friends with all the different cliques, from the nerdy kids to the heavy metal fans, to the depressed ones sitting in the back of the class. Man, I was so close. I was just not the big fan with the jocks. I did have some friends there, but didn't quite click there.
That's that charismatic aura, and this is the picture of it. The story goes, a couple lost their dog while hiking in Kamchatka. Remind me to tell you why that's important later, and they fired up a drone to try and find him. Oh, they did. They found him. Traveling with three bears. There's a lot to unpack here. Number one, bears don't live in packs, thank the natural order for that, but that means this husky had the stones to pull up on a mother bear with cubs and didn't get sent to dog backwards. Not to mention, there are wolves in Kamchatka, meaning bears already have a predilection of canine prejudice. But speaking of Kamchatka, not only does it flex the highest density of brown bears on Earth, the constant fresh supply of salmon means they're one of the few animals alive that could maul a grizzly. So I'm not exaggerating, this dog chose the biggest land predators on the planet and adopted them. Yeah, he adopted them. You can tell they're just barely tolerating him. Whole time, the husky's having the time of his life. Does this look familiar? I'll give you a hint.
I'm making waffles.
Yeah. Shrek. Yes. I recently watched that with my daughter, and it's made extra funny because we have this thing. Excuse me. Because my child is going to suffer the curse, or perhaps blessing, of having to cycle through four languages as she grows up, because we are just that multicultural in our home. And so I was watching Shrek with her in English and not Danish, and when it came to donkey, she could literally pronounce Shrek without an issue at all. But for some reason, the K in donkey kind of fails, so she says donkey, so almost doggy. So yeah, kind of a thing that kind of rang there. It's kind of funny to me, at least.
And I just know it was the mom telling the cubs, ignore him and he'll go away, that got him here. That's the real reason she doesn't suplex his world. Because then she'd be admitting she was wrong. There's no report the couple got their dog back, but I don't think that's not their dog no more. Especially since if I had a nickel for every time a drone caught a dog breaking bear boundaries, I'd have at least two more nickels than I woke up with. Oh, and it's more than just dogs. In 2018, a Polish farmer lost one of his cows, and for 2 months straight, she was unaccounted for. That is, until she was caught posted up with a herd of wild, untamed bison.
Yep, we've seen this image before. It's the one that led to many people calling the cow Piper. And if you know what I'm saying, you already have the image in your head. I might be editing it right now. Of course she did. She was the new girl in town, so
I'm not going to continue that joke. Sorry.
I could make the joke here, but I don't want to give guidelines a chance, so hopefully the comments do it for me. Yeah, don't get it twisted. How you think they make pound beef? In 2016, another drone captured a pod of beluga whales that had adopted a single lone narwhal. Just for reference, narwhals are painfully shy, people-fearing, eternally introverted anxiety whales that could genuinely get past tense by a panic attack. But as of 2022, he's been running with the same beluga squad every year. This is Aura. Also, fun fact, narluga hybrids are an actual thing, so maybe this is the same vibe. Probably helps that despite resembling a sun-starved dolphin, belugas have the intimidation of a cinnamon roll. Next animal looks like a cinnamon roll, but could absolutely fold you.
The two-week-old unrefrigerated pie.
You know, when I saw this video, my first thought, that golden retriever's there strictly for vibes.
No, that's not a golden retriever. That's another breed. I should ask my neighbor again. The literal thing that I said was bigger than the black bear live underneath there, which, by the way, by the end of this one, if I have the time before it gets dark, because, well, it's Denmark, it's getting pretty dark right now, I might show you the goats. I'm literally living in the farm right now. And by goats, I mean literally goats.
Come to realize that's not a golden retriever, it's a furry grim reaper. It's a Great Pyrenees, a canine insurance policy built to run phase with wolves and bears. It's
Well, no, that's not. No, that was Enzo. That's the actual German Shepherd.
Old man, country strength in a canine's body. If you meet someone's Pyrenees for the first time and they're all over you, yeah, that's not affection. It's basically a vibe check, and fail at your own expense, because the moment you do something they don't like to them, or God forbid someone they care about... This is Casper. He's not a ghost, but damn it if he doesn't make him. He's a 21-month-old, 85-pound cotton-tip goofball, at least according to owner John Werville. He lets chickens sleep on his head, he treats the sheep like family, and he's pretty outgoing for a guard dog. Until it's time to go out and be a guard dog. On November 3rd, 2022, 11 coyotes raided the farm in Georgia, and 3 managed to break into a pen. If that wasn't motivation enough, Casper also had a mate, Daisy, who was pregnant with 8 puppies.
Excuse me, did the photographer just use an insane amount of flash to make the shot, or is the dog's eyes just really bloodshot? Because that sounds like a creature that would go after you and yell racial slurs. This looks straight up demonic.
Casper also had a mate, Daisy, who was pregnant with 8 puppies. Casper knew what time it was. Casper cleared the 4-foot hogwire fence and not so gently perp walked the first 3 off the census in seconds. Casper then jumped the fence again and this time went after the entire pack, and even with 5 other Pyrenees on the farm, Casper went at it alone. No backup, this was personal. Casper would disappear for 2 days, until reappearing with cuts, torn skin, and a severely injured tail that ended up getting amputated. I'd show the other guys, but corpses aren't allowed on YouTube. The next day, people found the bodies of the decommissioned coyotes littered around railroad tracks, the carnage totaling 8 dead coyotes. If you remember how many unborn pups they pressed, I don't believe 8 was an accident. Casper would spend 2 weeks at the emergency vet and another 6 at the animal clinic to treat his wounds of war. But thanks to Samaritans donating $15,000 to his medical bills, Casper would make a full recovery.
Casper truly said that this is personal. Good boy.
And in 2024, he was voted the People's Choice Pup and won Farm Dog of the Year. Today, Casper's retired, and after single-handedly saving his entire bloodline, as he should. Next animal also retired, but only after saving his entire species. Except this is the one time the aura came from stolen valor. Aura fraud is a crime, and his prehistoric plus-size pebble committed it. Giant tortoises actually used to be seasoned all over, but that changed the moment folks discovered how good turtle meat tastes.
Oh, yikes. So long, gay Bowser.
Too ridiculous. You know, they didn't get a scientific name for hundreds of years, all because the sailors traveling with them kept eating them before they made it back to London. It got to the point where the population of giant tortoises on Española Island was 3 males and 12 females away from getting discontinued permanently. They started a breeding program, but off the bat, only 2 males were able to contribute. That was, until they realized that a tortoise living in the San Diego Zoo had actually been born on Española, and DNA tests confirmed that Diego was exactly what they were looking for, and so recruited him. Diego peeped the census and immediately came to his senses. He locked in. They said, "Go, Diego, go." Boy, did he ever. 3 male Hood Island tortoises were brought into the breeding program, and Sir Diego proceeded to score a career high in spreading thighs. Do turtles even have... Yes.
Yeah, boy.
No! No! No. Don't remind me of the weird crossovers that I've come across in the Sonic franchise. Like Mario vs. Sonic crossing over and people go like, we're gonna make some extremely degenerate art out of this. Why? Guys, why? You are cursing some of us who have the mental capacity of remembering just about everything that we've come across and... Damn it.
With more rounds than Nick's cannon, the amorous anvil with legs spawned 900 children and fathered 40% of all the tortoises born in the program, forever immortalizing him as a turtle who laid so much pipe he carried the species. And I do mean carry, there were three males, but one of them literally couldn't bump shells if their species depended on it. Either that, or it was one of those watching turtles. Now, I'm not a mathematologist, but three males with one pulling 40% and the other contributing vibes means Diego wasn't the MVP. That turtle was E5, and logic says his loins were responsible for 60% of the output.
This dude was like, what we do in the shadows?
But apparently Diego being a bigger, louder personality means he siphoned E5's clout, although to be fair, being named after a fucking bingo space didn't help. E5 was quiet, reserved, and rarely witnessed in the act. Meanwhile, Diego was the type to crash Keratin and let the whole island hear about it. This was a turtle too, man, that went on a...
I swear, if Diego was doing the turtle sound, I bet the people were dying of laughter on the island every single day.
A legendary run to save their species, which now numbers 2,300 on Española. Both tortoises have retired and have since been returned to their native island almost 80 years after they were first recruited. Wow. Moral of the story, there's a lot in a name. Call a bear a boss and he'll act like one. Name a shell jockey after the spawn of Elon, you're setting both up for failure. But failure's not even a concept to the next animal, because when you talk about Aura, this guy might have won himself a life supply. This is Jacob the Ion. Ion cuz he just refuses to take the L. And earlier this year, he and his brother broke a record in the most unexpected way possible. But to really appreciate how insane this is, you need to know just how they got here. Jacob belongs to a super rare population of tree-climbing lions in Queen Elizabeth National Park. What was really rare was his plot armor. In 2019, 5-year-old Jacob stepped on a wheel trap, a brutal torture device meant to bring down buffalo and hippos. Yeah. That'd be curtains for most lions, but Jacob managed to escape, although not without sacrificing a leg. And although he was kept alive by pride mates bringing him food and rangers eventually treating his wound with antibiotics, the chances a three-legged lion can last more than a year are low, and they were about to get a lot worse. In March 2020, six of Jacob's family members were poisoned by poachers and body parts sold on the black market. Being a tripod predator is already life on impossible mode. Doing that without a pride behind you is a for sure death sentence. Death seemed even more certain because 6 weeks after that, Jacob was gored by a buffalo, gifting him a gruesome puncture hole in his chest.
What the hell, Mother Nature? Was just putting the bloody thing through the ringer. You get an amputation. You lose your family. You get a puncture in the gut. What's the next thing? Freaking fratricide? By the whatever's left of his family? Dude. I mean, the fact that he's still alive is definitely a bit of plot armor, but... Gee damn.
Somehow Jacob survived everything, but the jihad of life didn't end there. Even with brother Tibu by his side, there's one big risk with being alive without a pride, and one night, it happened. Jacob and Tibu lost a fight with a rival group of males, and as lion culture states, all losers must be banished from the territory. Problem was, the only way out involved crossing the Kazinga Channel.
Reaver demons. Oh my. Okay. The unluckiest lion ever since Mufasa. Was killed by his brother.
A channel believed to hold the world's largest population of hippos and crocodiles. Both a massive threat to an Afro-Kitty's way of life. Jacob had already beat the odds like a Cherokee drum, but this time had to be too much. They did it. Jacob and Tibu swam nearly a mile across croc and hippo-seasoned waters at night. It was the longest distance a lion has ever been recorded swimming, and in Kazinga, most don't make it past 100 meters. The brothers lasted a length of 14 football fields, and the craziest part? It didn't take one try. It took three attempts, and one of them ended with a mysterious creature stalking them and forcing the pair back to shore. Do you know the nerve it takes to swim through a steroid lizard luncheon and a hippo pool party in the dark for 45 minutes straight while having no way of knowing if something's following you? What even motivates two lions to risk their entire lives swimming through a literal, yeah, that'd do it? it. You see, lions often mark their territory with roaring, and after losing that crucial fight, the pair heard the sounds of lionesses and the promise of promiscuity on the other side of hell. So yeah, lioness? Nah, them boys did it for the lion yash.
What was it that Ja Rule said? It's the power of the P-U-S-S-Y.
Let's pray this lion gets laid, cause that DNA going to waste would be the real tragedy. Second time this video, animals went on a two-man to save the lineage, but the next animals are the ratio of destruction hell-bent on destroying everyone else's. But if you know anything about honey badgers, you know this Oreo otter puts the aura in horrifying. The same dust weasel that sleeps off snake venom and goes 3v1 on hyenas and steals solos. Yep. And there wasn't a honey menace with more aura than Stawful.
Here we go. He's back, baby. Once again, I am using that good old meme of what a honey badger wishes he could be.
Let me tell you something about Stawful. Stawful is disrespect in the form of a Black Air Force bowl cut weasel. He's the mascot of habitual line stepping, and like IBS, you can't stop him, you can only pray to contain him. He was actually found by caretaker Brian Jones, credits to the weasel distribution system, but Stawful is like a four-legged tornado in his home, nuking the place and daring him to do something about it. Eventually, he brought Stawful to the Mahala Hala Animal Rehabilitation Center, and if you think being around other animals calmed this Tasmanian devil, you don't know Stawful. There wasn't a single animal this furry thumbtack wouldn't beef with, from messing with a rhino 100 times his size, to running a fade with a serval next door, to even folding an adult tawny eagle. No foul. He'd also harass kitchen staff and help himself to the fridge. Who was gonna stop him? And it turned out, Stawful wasn't fit to be released to the wild, so this felon ferret was here to stay.
No harm done. I'm innocent. All the while, all the staffers are looking at him and going like, straight to jail, right away.
At one point, he dug through an electric fence and started bullying the lions, specifically chasing the male around and trying to bite his lion bits.
Yes.
The lion actually grabbed Stawful, but fun fact, honey badgers are built like a comeback, and loose skin around the neck meant he could turn around and bite the lion right back. He must have been feeling himself, because Stawful ended up going back to the lions a second time and nearly got mauled to death, spending over 2 months in the animal hospital. And the first thing this monochrome crash out did fresh out was try to get it back in blood, and at this point, Brian knew he had to lock up his war weasel for his own good, and that's when things really got disrespectful. In his new enclosure, Stawful climbed a tree by a wall and got out, should have seen that coming, but then they removed all the trees by the wall. The convict spent all night bending and twisting a branch until it broke, carried it to a wall, leaned it against, and escaped again, so now all the trees were out. Low diff for the Stawful. This time he dug up all the rocks in the enclosure, stacked them high enough, and emancipated himself again. So there went the rocks, but like a fool, they left him with mud. A few mud piles later, and Harry Houdini humbled them again. One time someone made the mistake of leaving a rake in there. Guess what?
Yeah.
At one point, they thought they were bringing in a love interest named Hammy, but all they really did was literally gift him a partner in crime. Like Shadow Clone Jutsu, now there was two of them. There was one night Stawful broke into his caretaker's home via rocks to the window and even tried the door. No one got hurt, but sometimes it's about sending a message. Sometimes you gotta pop out and show Nick. He made it clear that every second he was behind a wall was a choice.
Goddamn the Kendrick line. Didn't see that coming.
Because there's a twist. It was all a game. The Weasel Menace had been hand-raised by humans his entire life and had imprinted on them. He wasn't going anywhere. Fun fact, honey badgers are like the mama's boys of mustelids, with pups staying with their mothers for up to 2 years. As far as Stawful was concerned, Brian was mama. So yeah, Casper was fueled by family. And Jacob's motivation was hakuning some tatas. This dusty sand weasel was memeing the entire time, and I checked, he's still alive. He's currently 27 and has lost most of his teeth, but he still has Hammy to chew his meals for him. Stawful even has a son named Stumpy, guaranteeing that the family business is alive at least another generation. But yeah, that's gonna do it for this video. Make sure you drink water, hug your mother. If you ever wanted to meet Stawful, you should probably get on that. And I'ma see y'all in the next one.
He even outlived most honey badgers by a large margin. Stawful is built different. Oh, that's sweet. So here's the thing, when I'm watching videos like this, right, sometimes of course I have background knowledge about certain things, but most importantly, when I'm getting all of the imagery of what these animals have done, I'm always picturing how the hell am I going to depict that in a thumbnail?
because I want to kind of like do them justice because it's so much fun. I did the one with Stoffel previously, right? With the cat meme. But like right now, I'm sort of feeling like doing the same again. But yeah, eventually we'll see what we come up with. You know what? I actually have an idea about making a video on animals that sort of affected the course of history. And there are a lot to pull out from. I might be working on that for next month or by the end of this one. We'll see eventually. But guys, thank you so much for checking out this video. As always, if you liked it, don't forget to go and subscribe to Casual Geographic. What an awesome dude. And of course, if you like this one, don't forget to hit that like button. And I see you guys in the next one. Bye.